Research finds that 69% of developers lose at least one day a week as they're maintaining their environments, while only 33% of their time is spent on innovating. This emphasizes the urgent need for secure modular workspaces that accelerates builds, governs AI usage, and reduce cloud's waste. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the practice lead and principal analyst for application development, and I'm joined today by Rob at Coda. Rob, how are you doing today?
I'm doing really well, Paul. Thanks for having me.
Great to have you on. I'm really excited about this conversation. This is it seems like a topic that has been, you know, going on for a long time, right? We've been hearing this kind of the same kind of stat for, I would say, for many years, but I think that there's a lot of acceleration here. Why don't you introduce yourself and introduce Coda a little bit to the audience?
Sure. So again, thanks for having me. Rob Whiteley, I'm the CEO here at Coda. Got to join here about 2.5 years ago. And help us grow to the next stage. And Coda, I think it's most easily explained as we're trying to solve developer productivity. And then within developer productivity, we're laser focused on onboarding. How do we get a developer up and running with the right tools, with or without AI, in a way that's safe and productive? And I think that's been sort of our laser focus. And I would really think of it as we have been shipping code to the cloud. We've been running code in the cloud, testing, building, deploying, all of that, but we still write it locally on laptops. And so I think the easiest way to think about it is we're trying to shift that last part of the software development lifecycle to also be cloud.
Yeah, that's incredibly important. I think in this day and age, especially with the introduction of AI, we have AI is really accelerating the workflow. We're really seeing in our research this fast-paced digital economy that's really emphasizes the fact that developer productivity is under pressure. You know, and really enterprises are racing to accelerate builds. We're seeing in our research 24% of organizations want to release code on an hourly basis. So this is really fast, right? They're also looking to integrate AI coding agents and manage rising cloud costs. So that really helps with what we talked about. And then when we look at this, most developers, I opened this up with, most developers are constrained by inefficient workflows, spending 66% of their time on this maintenance instead of innovation. And that's really, it's really kind of coming out in our research as well. This imbalance, Rob, is really kind of not only delaying software development delivery, it also hampers competitiveness. It also makes for secure, scalable, and ephemeral environments essential for organizations that want to modernize application development, but they also need to maintain governance and cost efficiencies at the same time. Yeah. So I'd love to get your take. Let's jump right in. We started with the stat. We started about the innovation versus maintenance. What are your thoughts here? How does a secure environment, how does a new kind of a new approach, how does that flip the ratio to give developers more room for creativity and high value work?
Yeah, I think the most important thing is when, and we saw this really happen sort of in the pandemic, when everyone had to go remote, we ended up in a world where we sort of reimagined what a developer workflow could look like. And it didn't have to be just a local laptop or a virtual desktop environment. Like Citrix was probably one of the most common developer environments for the longest time. And I think what we're seeing now is what we need to focus on is how do we get a developer into their preferred way of writing code, which could be an IDE, it could be with an AI collaborator, but do it in a way where we just remove all the friction. I think the challenge with developers is they're smart. And I say that a little cheekily, because ultimately they will tinker with their environments. They will try to get the tools dialed in. They'll try to get everything dialed in perfectly for their particular workflow, but then they end up in a completely unknown state. And a lot of what we've seen is that getting into that, drifting into that area is really what kind of sets developers askew. And that's why so much time is spent on that maintenance and not on the actual thing they were hired to do, which is write code and build applications.
Yeah, I agree. I think that there's a lot that has to do with the fact that AI and governance is a big factor now as we start moving forward with this development process, right? We're seeing that the applications are not only being developed by the professional developers, right? You said that they're smart, they kind of tinker with their environments and they kind of modify things. But what we're also seeing is applications now with the introduction of AI is really being developed at the lines of business, right? We're seeing that that's becoming more of a everyone's a developer kind of stage versus the professional developers doing the, you know, the piece. But that it also means that there's an incredible importance around governance as well. So when we look at, you know, AI coding agents, that's really rapidly entering developer workflows, right? We're seeing that as a as an area where big governance challenges enterprise face. Well, I guess how does you know, products and environments like Coder help with the safe experimentation around these lines of businesses without risk of IP or challenging the AI compliance issues that within those or those lines of businesses?
Yeah, yeah. And something you said really resonates with me. And the way I think about it is sort of the definition of a developer has changed. For the longest time, developer equals software engineer. And now I think a developer is pretty much anyone who is writing an application to get their job done. And I think we first saw a little bit of this expansion when data scientists, who are sort of a form of citizen developer, kind of hit the scene where they're doing a lot with Python. And they probably didn't identify as a software engineer, but they're really trying to figure out, how do I do basic software engineering principles to train an AI model or ML model? Now we have the dreaded vibe coders, which are really these folks who are just trying to solve a business problem. And they're happily leaning on AI to kind of quickly stand up a dashboard or a simple line of business application, like generating an invoice. I start there because if we really want to think about developers, we first have to expand the definition of what a developer is. But then we end up more to the challenges you talked about. These are folks that, unlike the traditional software engineer, are not as comfortable tinkering with the environment. And quite frankly, you probably wouldn't want them to, either for security purposes or productivity purposes. And so now we're in this world where we want to get AI up and running because it is a great peer programmer for a software engineer. And it's a great virtual software engineer for a line of business owner that just wants their own virtual teammate. And so a lot of our energy now goes into, how do you create that environment? How do you give it all the guardrails so that it's safe for AI to be functioning? And then finally, how do you make sure that it has all of the tools it needs to be successful? No more, no less.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I think when we think about that context, as developer and applications kind of are being developed across different areas, and AI is being introduced to do this, developers in every context of the term developer, right? And developers often lose days and time setting up their environments for really troubleshooting for inconsistencies, right? This is actually equally important as we start moving towards using AI to develop applications and standardizing. But when we think about it, I would like to your perspective on how does standardization with container-based workspaces really impact that onboarding speed, build times, and the CI/CD pipeline reliability? Because that piece really, in my mind, whether you're, again, regardless who you are as a developer, if you're using this, if you're vibe coding, you still need to be in compliance and regulations. Otherwise, you're talking about, the data getting out of in the public, and we can't have that, right? Data is the lifeline of the business. So how does that help with, how do organizations think about this in that new context?
Yeah, I think the easiest way to think about it is, it's almost like a hyper-specialized virtual desktop. And I hate to keep going back to that term, but it's easiest to kind of wrap our head around. I, as someone trying to write software engineer or line of business, I need access to an environment. I need access to source code. I need access to specific tools and tool chains. And all of that is going to be dependent on the language I'm writing in. And the further we go to line of business, the more I don't even know the answers to these questions. And so really what we're seeing is, you can store all of that information as code. You can have that all as configuration as code, infrastructure as code, policy as code. And what that allows you to do is empower a platform team that owns central tooling to standardize those environments and then just spin them up. So as far as I'm concerned, I click on an icon, I'm in my environment, I'm either talking to my AI buddy or I'm in my favorite IE. That's it. I don't worry about anything more from a user or a developer experience. And instead, I'm pushing all that complexity to an automation and a standardization engine that allows me to run that as infrastructure as code. That's the real power that unlocks both the security and cost.
Yeah, I think that also makes it more repeatable for organizations, right? So they can actually have call templates or work spaces that they could just roll out to, you know, whoever it is. So the person that's working on writing a code or doing their job effectively don't have to spend their time in that 66% maintenance mode. They can just take a templatized workspace and just go and work and run it. It's a standardized environment. The onboarding process is much faster. But let's pivot a little bit and talk about the cost optimization, right? When we think about this, cloud costs are rising and many development environments really sit idle for about 70% of their time, right? Even with bedtime scripts, they sit idle. So let's talk a little bit about how does on-demand and auto-scaling compute and how does that really help organizations better align to their infrastructure spending with the actual developer activity versus, those idle times when they're downtime?
Yeah. Yeah, and I think we saw a generation ago an attempt to solve this by let's just put big, beefy virtual machines in the cloud, in a data center, and we'll allow developers to access that. That way, all the source code is safe, it's behind our firewall, and we have these nice, repeatable environments. The problem is, I don't know what my developers' needs are, so I'm probably going to run that 24/7, or to your point, I might have a script that gently powers things down, but it was really just taking the laptop-based world we'd always been in and just hosting it in the cloud. We're completely rethinking it to how do you provision in time for the developer so that they have just the amount of compute they need at the time they need it for the particular task they're trying to do. And then you're actually spinning that up and down. So it's much more, by the way, in VMs or containers, but the way you can do this now is be much less about how do I provision for peak capacity, which is very, very expensive, and instead just provision for what the developer is doing at that moment. And then more importantly, using kind of all we've learned around financial cloud management for cost optimizing, which cloud to run it in, what resource, what kind of base image, all of this stuff can now be automated. And again, the developer doesn't think about it. As far as they're concerned, they're just coming into their environment and I have an SLA and I can almost think of it as like t-shirt sizing. I need small, medium, or large. And that's all I have to do is specify what I'm looking for and boom, we can take care of the rest. But that's where, and it's, by the way, it's about an order of 75% or more cloud savings when you're pushing all of this into infrastructure as code and automation.
So I want to bring it back to AI again, because I know that, you know, of course, we can't have a conversation without having AI in it, you know, at every aspect of the conversation. But I think that when you look at, you know, AI ops, right, and you look at what's happening within the ecosystem, that would trigger certain actions that are to occur so you can actually have those cost savings and basically having the ability to power things on, power things off, move code. In my world of, you know, in the app dev space, I talk quite a bit about past, present, and future. And a lot of times I'm talking about like the present state is around containerization and around Kubernetes and around like what's happening. And the past state could be siloed monolithic applications, heritage applications, even virtualized applications. But then when I think about future state, I think about in the context of, you know, what's going to happen next for cloud native applications and cloud adoption. So if you think about things like WASM or WebAssembly, right? That's something that it may be future state, but it's also what we're seeing in our research that 39% of organizations are using it, right? So it's a kind of an area that it's interesting in my mind on where it's going. But you know, with that, I also want to talk about the future of platform engineering, right? I mean, we talked about, you know, enterprises that are looking at these local tool chains towards governing cloud native platforms, you know, but they also have what role that they need to kind of play in a secure environment to help enable innovation for at scale, not just, you know, around the professional developer, but the low code users as well as, and this is the big part in my mind, when you're looking at MCP and A2A and using agents, AI agents in order to extract data from heritage systems, that's a big part of governance, security, and regulations. So how do you see the future of platform engineering kind of playing out in that space?
Yeah, I think, so we're huge fans of the power of what coding agents can do in particular. So I think we're in a second generation of AI already. The first generation was just those code assistance tools. It helps me complete a line of code or do some basic research. When we talk about where AI is now, we're talking fully autonomous agents. You can give them small tasks up to actually fairly large projects, and they work autonomously. But to do that, they need access to real code. They need access to real tools. They need real credentials. And so it can become an extreme risk and compliance nightmare if you're just saying, I'm going to give my agent the same privilege I would give a human. So a lot of what we've spent our time is, how do we create an environment where the human and the agent can be collaborating? The agent has a restricted set of permissions. And so to your point, I might want to firewall them down so they don't have internet access. That way they can't go out and do anything harmful. Or I'm just going to say just these services I'm going to allow the agent to use, probably using MCP as an example, as kind of the standard way to equip a developer. And so what we're really getting to is creating a world where we can almost treat the developer as a contractor, an untrusted third-party entity inside the exact same workspace as the developer. And now we're able to have a lot more confidence, kind of give them all the access, give them the tooling, and they can run. And we're already seeing customers that are running agents where 10, 20% of their code base has now been autonomously written by agents in production. Did a human check it? Absolutely. No one trusts pushing the code to production. But the quality, when you give them the right boundaries and you give them the right context and the right tools, these agents really are shockingly effective.
Yeah, you touched on something. Human in the loop is absolutely necessary at this point, because it's still a requirement in most organizations. Rob, this has been really great having you on. There's a lot to talk about. I know that we kind of touched on a lot of different points here. I also know, because I've been working with you on this and the team at Coder on this, is we have a research brief coming out. We're excited to get that launched and published. But for the audience purpose, where would you recommend the audience go to learn more about what we're talking about here?
Yeah, so you can always go to coder.com to learn more, or if you go to github.com/coder, we actually are an open source project, and so you can actually get started with the technology there.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, Rob, thank you again for joining us today. This has been really great. I know it's a lot to talk about in a short period of time, so we had a lot to discuss here. And thank you to the audience for who tuned in. We really appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. But that wraps up this episode today. And we'll be back next Wednesday with another conversation diving into the tools, trends, and talents shaping the future of application development. Whether you're deploying on the edge, building with AI, or modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. Be sure to follow us on social if you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.